This is JPEG The Raw, show number 190. We're coming on an odd night. It's a Thursday night. But we also have a special topic tonight. Oh, and before we get started, Gary's asking, where is Tim? Since this is an odd night, it's a Thursday night. We normally do these on Tuesday nights. Tim, you know, has a young family, and he is at some event for his daughter, which I think is like every Thursday to the summer. So we won't typically do these on Thursdays, but for tonight, that means Tim will not be with us. We have Gary and a Greg. So Gary and Greg, hopefully can watch both of your chats. All right, tonight we're going to be going over a special topic. That is the best of 2016 photo contest. We have two groups that were involved in the contest. One is our main JPEG to RAW group, and then the other one is our beginners group. And I think AD, and let me introduce you, AD Wheeler, who's a co-host over on our photo review show, been on JPEG to RAW a number of times, is the creator behind the explorographer.com, drone master, photo master, 3D print master. I got to stop watching your feed because you get me hooked on too many things. You are printing some incredibly awesome stuff. If you don't follow AD over on Facebook, you should. He is always into the cool stuff, and it's fun to watch and live through him.
I am a tech junkie.
You are, yes. So tonight let's go over the photos from the beginner group first, and I need to get a couple of things set here where I get rid of the lower third, and then I can pull up the first photo. First photo is from
Donnell. Cox.
Yeah.
Yes. Donnell. It says Donella.
Donella. Donella. Yeah. Donella. And it is a daughter looking up at her, and she has done a black and white conversion.
Nice.
So, and this is our beginners group. So they're out there trying to take photos and, you know, all the different skill levels, of course, and actively trying to get better. So any feedback on this one?
Well, just, you know, without one of the things that's going to help you get better if you submit more to the show and I get a chance to look at them and help you out with them is the fact that we need to know, like, what you are going for with the image. Now, obviously, you're at Epcot and we kind of got that. But it's kind of when you snap a photo, when you get your camera and you're like, oh, I want to get a picture of so and so. When you put it up to your eye and you press that button, you have a thought that runs through your head. And that's what I need to hear. I need to hear from you. Like, I just thought it was cool that we were at Epcot Center and I wanted to kind of, like, you know, feature my daughter or whatever. If that's what you were going for here and you give a nice empty negative space there to balance her with in the image, then that works out great. I think that you did a nice job there. She's kind of half smiling. I think I would have liked to seen her smile a little bit more if we're excited to be at Epcot Center. But, you know, she's your daughter. You know kind of what her look is all about and all that kind of stuff. And without me knowing anything more than just that you are at Epcot Center, it's tough for me to give you any advice in that direction. I will say the tone of the image is excellent. Your black and white toning is wonderful here. It's nice and balanced. It's not too contrasty. And it's not too kind of faded. I think it's right in that kind of groove zone for portraits. And without knowing, again, anything more about what you're going for, like if you said to me, well, I was trying to get a high key shot, then I could explain to you what that is and how to get a high key black and white or something like that. But for natural light, just snapping a photo here, it's a nice job. The eyes are nice and in focus. One thing I'm going to mention to everybody tonight, there's one image here that did the watermark perfectly, and I'm going to point that out when we get to it. Be very careful with large watermarks, and the only reason why is especially if you're submitting to something such as a critique, because they're very distracting for the person to look at and critique the image. It's very hard for me to erase your logo from my brain and kind of look at this photo beyond your logo being there. Now, advertising is great, but we're going to talk about, you know, you and your photos. So you're going to get some advertising out of it. And if it's your own kid, then you don't really need to put a watermark on it. If you have to put a watermark, if you just can't live without a watermark, try to hide the watermark in the photo so that it's less distracting. Lighten it up a little bit even more. Like it, this could be lightened up quite a bit more and put down in the corner and, you know, just big enough so that we can see who you are and see, you know, if we want to get to you. I do urge people, if you have a website, you know, put your website in there unless you're super confident that you're the only Don Cox out on Google, which I'm going to assure you that you're probably not. Make sure you put your website in there. Don't put the www. Everybody does that. That's no longer used. Just put your website name. So if it's doncoxphotography.com or however you have it, I would put that in there is the most important part of if you're trying to advertise or if you're trying to. And of course, you need to follow that up with making sure your website is awesome as well. But try to just make your watermarks not as in your face for critiques. I understand on the internet and you're trying to keep people from stealing your photos and all that kind of stuff. Very important. And you have to do certain things in that aspect of it. But I think for something like a critique like this, please try to keep them out of the way so we can enjoy the photo and I can give you the best answer for you. And that filling in that other information. So I think the only thing I have to add other than the black and white is there's a little bit of speck there I'm looking at and I can see it in her hair. You're going to want to try to use a spot removal tool to take that out. Content Aware fill in Photoshop or Lightroom has a little healing tool or even Pocket Android apps, Snapseed even has a little healing tool you can pop on there and get that little speck of dust out of there so, you know, her hair looks nice and everything there. So, but other than that, I love the tone. I think the thing that really gets me and the composition here, nice job on the composition, because especially in the beginners group, because I've seen people even more advanced struggle with composition. We talk about it all the time, Mike and I do on the show. And you did a nice job here. I think it's well balanced. So good job.
Very good. Yeah, I'm glad you brought up the thing about the watermark because this one is a little overpowering. And some people may not ever want to make money from their photos. It's just a hobby. And maybe they don't have a website, but they may have a place where they store their photos. Maybe they have a Flickr account or something like that. Where you want people to go to see your other work. If you ever want to make money from it, you know, you really probably need a central location, which is your webpage. All right. So very good, Dawn. Dawn has been a member of our group for a long time and has already come a long way. So very good, Dawn.
All right. Yeah, next, awesome.
Next
good,
is a name
to
we're,
see this stuff.
Yeah. Next is a name we're all familiar with, and that is Thomas Sadlin. And Thomas, this one's different than any of the other photos because this is a photo of a painting he did. So I don't know how that works into the qualifications of the contest, but it is a photo, but a photo of a painting he did. And that's why you're seeing this odd thing in the upper right-hand corner of what looks like a part of a table along the top edge in the left. Yep. So I don't know if we're going to be able to critique the photo part of this. I think the drawing is better than anything I could ever do.
Yeah, the drawing's great. I would have liked to know some information more about how he achieved the drawing and what he was going for in an art print maybe here or just, you know, taking a picture of something. Without this information, I will be honest. I'm going to be perfectly honest with you guys because I do a lot of these critiques. And so and a lot of times people will hear me, and I know that Mike has said this before about me, that I see a photo and I always pull something positive out of that. So one of the things I have to be careful with is, and we're all susceptible to this today, and I am definitely not saying that Thomas is doing this, but I don't know Thomas as well as you do, Mike. Mm-hmm. So when I first saw this, I was like, am I being trolled? Because this is a picture of a drawing. And then the information posted is, this is my best photo for the year. So it confused me right off. I'm like, is someone leading me down this road, wanting me to like try to pull something good out of a drawing and call it a photo? So it's very confusing without you stating to me what you were going for here. Right. So let me go down a few avenues for you guys, and then Thomas, you can pull out whatever you want to pull out. And I'd love to talk to you more about you know, what you were going for here. So, you know, you can reach out to me. Any of you guys can reach out to me. I'm very available and I'm always here. This is what I do. So, but I think if this was going to be an art print and one of the things that I do, my girlfriend does art, she does acrylics and all this kind of stuff. And we put them online for print so that they can be printed and people can buy prints of them. We don't sell the originals unless we, you know, put them in a gallery or something. So in order to transfer those to a printable, the light has to be right. You have to shoot them direct on. You have to light them a certain way so it doesn't look like there's shadows, that there's, you know, overlit from one side. Because if you just stick a light or a flash in front of a photo and try to take a photo, it just comes out like all weird, like a gradient on it and all sorts of weird stuff, especially with acrylic paints and whatnot. So if that was the case, an image like this of a drawing, I would consider, you know, natural light and make sure it's very even or always on light, or what they call modeling light, which is a light that stays on constantly. I wouldn't use a flash. You're going to definitely want to shoot it straight on and get rid of any distractions around the outside of like the table. A big no-no in any type of photography is a contrasty triangle in a corner. We as humans have a very hard time looking away from that. So in this particular photo, we've got that dark part of her hair in the drawing, and I'm looking at kind of that. I'm drawn to that because it's very contrasty there, but I keep getting pulled away from that with that corner of the table, which is dark in the corner. And that's natural. As a human being, we're drawn towards those contrasty corners. So this could be easily fixed in Photoshop in 2 seconds. You just outline that in content aware fill and it would fill it in with the paper. But then you have the issue of it's leaning back quite a ways, and you can really see her head is kind of scrunched down. So it's not really giving you, you know, the full effect of your work here. And it's amazing. The drawing is incredibly good. I, like Mike said, I could not approach anything of this caliber. And I think I would have liked to known a little bit more about that. And then we could talk about how, you know, we can turn your artwork into a printable item using your camera, making sure your white balances, how to use a gray card. When you shoot something like this, you would shoot a gray card next to the actual drawing for a reference. And then without changing the settings on your camera, then you would take another shot of the actual drawing without the gray card. And then when you're in Lightroom, what you do is you click on the one with the gray card and you set your white balance, and then you just copy that setting to the other one. You got a perfect white balance on your art print, which is very important when you're doing prints of artwork. But without knowing, I don't know. So Thomas, I urge you, definitely reach out to me, man. I'd love to talk to you more about this if I can. If you have, you know, questions or how to do that or what you were going for, because to me, it's a mystery at this point.
He definitely has some artistic skills there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And AD, you mentioned a gray card. Gray cards are super cheap. You can get them for super cheap. You can, we're not focused on us right now, but I've shown the X-Rite card that I have behind me. But just a standard gray card, you can get them, you know, really cheap and keep it in your bag. All right, up next is this image from Nancy Smith, Nancy Zumbach Smith.
Yep. And I thought this was an adorable photo. I don't know. Mike, you're jumping on these too, man. I know I'm just rattling them off, but I'm picking up your cues.
And this, you know, this is a girl that is waiting on train tracks. I love train tracks photos, although they're a minor thing here. But to me, there's a story here with the girl who's either waiting. She must be going away, waiting for the train to come to go on her trip because she has her luggage there. It is from behind. I wish there's a little more contrast in the image. A little more in the detail in the sky. The sky looks a little bit overexposed, but I like the theme. I like what she's going after here.
Yeah, and perfect example of hiding your watermark, Nancy. Nice work. It is not distracting to me. It allows me to enjoy the image and figure out kind of a direction for you. Now, I don't have any information on this photo, but it's got very strong components, so I'm going to run with it because I kind of know. I'll just give you what I would do with the image, and hopefully this will give you some creative thoughts. So – I like the fact that it's kind of like a train station. We're not really sure. But you've got all the components here, the cute girl, you've got the suitcase all ready to go. You got the train tracks right there. I think I would have liked to have seen the train tracks become a little bit more prominent in the image, moving her more to the right.
And you can see down the train tracks a little better?
Well, down the train tracks, kind of see, you've kind of put the train tracks ending like right in her head somewhere. And so you've kind of made this target, right, that we can't get the whole scope of the image. It's very Norman Rockwell-like, so we need all of the components of the story to be told. Now, there's two weeds there on the right. Those are not anything like that, you know, anybody's going to be sad aren't there. I would probably would have removed those
physically
before I shot it. Physically removed them. just simply because they're just two weeds competing with her in the balance of the frame. They're kind of sitting there going, hey, look at us over here. We're photobombing this girl in the polka dot dress. Mm-hmm. And you don't, they don't need to be there. There's also a signpost right next to her that's leaning back, and that's competing with her as well. I think if you could have an idea of getting a little lower in the shot, which probably would have given you a little bit more sky, moving more to your left, giving you more train track, maybe a hint of the side of her face, you would have put her in front of that pole. By moving down lower, you would have masked that pole, would have been bye-bye with her. And then, you know, the plants, you could have knocked those out of the way. Now you have all of the components working together for you. Right now they're all in competition against you in this. I like the faded look to it. I'm going to go against Mike's contrasty look here. I think that artistically, for the kind of thing that we're going soft and innocent here, I think the faded kind of old film look kind of works for me. I think I would have worked a little bit on the toning or grading of the image a little bit. But like you said, these are beginner folks, and I don't want to pile on mm-hmm. too much to this. I think playing with the composition here and getting things to complement each other rather than try to compete with each other in the composition is very important. And this is a good photo to show that is
great feedback. It's, you know, not just for beginners, but for everybody. But that is great feedback for Nancy. So thank you there. Let's move on to the next one. This one is from Kristen Lee Anderson. Where do I have her name? Kristen Lee Anderson. It's a black and white photo of a girl looking back. You know, looks like she just spun around with her hair flinging in the air. I like the tone of this one, and the fact, you know, she is a little soft, but I actually like that. I'm not opposed to the softness. She's over in the thirds. Gosh, I don't know what I would say bad about this one, AD. I would probably have moved the photos by Kristen down. It's a little too, I don't like it up there. I would like it maybe in the lower left-hand corner or even behind her or smaller.
Yeah, again, it comes right down to make it very faint in the scene. Don't have it distract from the scene. You know, in a critique situation like this, doesn't need to be here. You can bring this photo in and show it, show your work, let your work work for you. We're going to talk about you. You know, so people are going to understand, you know, that, and you can always put it in the information, you know, my website is, and we'll mention it. I mean, mm-hmm. that's what we're here for. Sure. This is all about you guys, not about us for sure. Let me tell you what I really love about this photo. I think it's a very moody image. I love the fact that her hair is flowing with the tree light in the background. Mm-hmm. It has this whole kind of like ethereal kind of look to it. One of the things you got to be careful with, Kristen, is Border Patrol. And I've talked about this before. So you can't see it on mine, but I'll point to my screen like you can, and then maybe I can explain it so you can understand. The upper left-hand corner above your logo, there's a few dots of bokeh up there. Get rid of those. They're a distraction in the corner. They don't need to be there. You can easily clone those out. There's also one bright bokeh spot. If you go to her right eye and then kind of go up diagonal from there, mm-hmm. there's one spot there that's really sticking out. Eliminate that as well. And suddenly you have a very powerful image. You will be so surprised by removing those two little things and your logo, how much more powerful the image will seem to you because you've minimized these things that are fighting against this wonderful photo of your daughter. This photo, by the way, was I had a tie between the beginners of which ones I liked the best. This one was right there with it. And the only thing that kept it from being a clear winner was a little bit too much hair in her face. I think this could have been one of those photos, if you had the wind blowing and you just kind of had her take the little bit of hair out of her face, in the way she's turned right now and the way the wind's blowing, I think you could have done that fairly easy. I think that would have done it for me. But I like the film treatment. I like the dark kind of darkness of this. It has a dark kind of contrast to it. I like that as well. So excellent job on all of that kind of stuff. And just do your border patrol and little things. In the beginner group, I got to say, this a lot good, of great yeah. images here. Yeah.
Yeah. And Gary had a question that I was thinking too. You know, generally you say there's certain points of the body you don't cut off at certain points. One of them is around the wrist. This one, the cutoff starts a little bit after the elbow because your arm is at an angle. And so it does end right around the wrist, that angle going there. For me, because of that angle, I'm all right with the cutoff. Distract me.
I agree. So if she would have cut her off at the elbow, we would have had the same problem as if her arm was straight down and cut off at the wrist. So as long as the arm has got an angle to it, our brains put all of that kind of back in. So while that rule would really come into play when her arm was more down, straight down, and we cut off at the wrist. Here she did the right thing by keeping it below the elbow so that we could see the arm was bent. And yeah, so I don't think that that's quite the problem. Would it have been more powerful with her hand in it? I'd have to see it. And I'm sure she's got lots of shots. Mm-hmm. I don't think we just pull the button once. I think we let that shutter rip usually in instances like this. So
there's one other thing for me. There's a dark line that goes. It looks like around the S in her last name, Kristen, and goes down.
Yes, I see it.
That may just be the natural formation of the trees back there. And I don't know how, you can do what work you could have done there that wouldn't have made it worse.
No, she could probably, pull the darks down even darker. So it's a little it's kind of like a faded vignette here. And I wouldn't be afraid to take the blacks and pull them down a little bit more. And that would help blend that in. That's it looks like an evergreen tree back there. That's kind of got a sparse top on it or something. So, it didn't really distract me all that much because it's a very powerful image. I think that's the thing. Sometimes little distractions, things that are in the corners of the image, you got to be very careful with. So you always want to do your border patrol because things in the edges draw you away. I'm on a calibrated monitor right now, and I'm not really seeing too much of a contrast in that, although I do also have a bright light in my face as well. So.
And Kristen's out there in chat. So great image, Kristen.
Awesome. Yeah.
I hope you heard all the AD's feedback because it was awesome. All right, let's move on to the last one of the beginners group. And this one is from Alicia May. I'm saying her name right?
Alicia May.
Yep. I'm saying her name right? Alicia May.
Alicia May.
All right, so I like how she has it in the thirds over there. To me, that there's a weed that's coming up to our left. Weed that's coming up over there that's got a little ball on the top of it. I'd like to have probably cloned that one. I do like what she's done with her watermark here. She has a www, but that's all right. And her website address there. And it could have maybe been a little bit, not quite as bright, a little bit more transparent, but it doesn't distract me that much. The photo in this case, unlike the other one where I was okay with the softness, I would like this one to have been a little bit sharper.
Yeah, kind of torn on this because I think there's so much more creativity that you could pour into this tonally and with a with a maybe a softer look out in the edges and bring up the contrast on her a little bit more. The light off to the side is a little different too, rather than more having the light really highlight all the way around her hair, where I'm looking at, you know, like the flowers on the right side of her are nice and backlit, and it's got that beautiful, I'm shooting in the sunshine kind of look, whereas over on the right-hand side of her hair, stage right, I guess, our left, it doesn't have the highlighting, and, you know, it's in the shadow kind mm-hmm. of. I think the other thing that's bugging me a lot too, and I agree with the, I also agree with the one single, looks like cottonwood or whatever it is back there, weed that's sticking up. I would have definitely eliminated that and a little bit of why that's coming off that. The thing that's bugging me right now is the cutoff tattoo. And so, and for me, it's like one of those things where I can't stop looking at it now that I've found it.
Oh boy. Yep. Now you pointed it out. Yep.
And now I'm like, well, what does it say? What? Now I'm lost in the photo. Now I'm lost. So things like that, you know, maybe this is a too much up on the shoulder shot, and we needed to see a little bit more of her. If she has, you know, the tattoo there, if it's a case of where, the client says, I don't want the tattoo, can we try to get a shot? You know, then you got to take it out, take it off, mm-hmm. remove it, whatever needs to be done there. But it's either in or it's out. You know, that's the thing with an image like this. Again, folks, you're doing portraits. Be careful of the hair. You got hair moving across her neck. Make sure that, you know, that's, I know it's difficult. You got wind and everything outside, but prep your models when you're going into this. Teach them about a four count, all of that kind of stuff. And, you know, you can find videos on YouTube are great that you can kind of pre-teach people that you're going to take portraits of, so that they can kind of do their thing and you can do your thing, and you're not directing them or posing them. So a good model will run a four count in their head, and every fourth count, they will slightly change one thing. They'll either move their head a little bit, they'll move their hand, they'll change their posture or whatever. While they're occupied with doing that, you can just do your thing, and you're going to see your images are going to be a lot more natural. And then you can pay attention to things like hair in the way, things like that, where, you know, you'll notice that more rather than you spending the time trying to direct somebody. You're not being creative when you're doing that. You're going by the book. You're posing people. So definitely consider that when you're doing portraits and stuff like this. I think it's a great shot. I think I like the light. I like the tone. I think there's a little bit of, you know, redness in her that could be toned out a little bit here and there. A little bit of you know, from either the wind or whatever was going on that day. But yeah, I think it's a good shot, good possibilities here, and a workable image. That's what's so important, mm-hmm. is that there's, you know, you can work this image. There's still a lot of stuff that can be done.
Da772, I don't know what your name is, so I'm just going to go by what your username is out there, pointed out something that I missed, and that is above her head, there's a dark cone type, I guess that's a tree or something, happening yes. above her head that looks like it's spiking into her head. So there's that.
Wait a second. Is it like my plant problem that I have? You guys aren't seeing it right now, but yeah. I have a plant that's spiky behind me, and here, everybody's
I'll cut over to you. There you go.
There, see?
So now, yeah, you got spiky hair. Right. You got to watch that background. You know, this is a case where just the one before this, the one from Kristen, where the girl, we cut off at close to the wrist, but because it was at an angle, it was okay. Here, the body part cut off was fine, except it cut off a tattoo. So while the physical body part might have been okay with the cut off, there was something there where you didn't want to cut it off. So you can't always just go by hard rules there.
Right. Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, that's the other thing. Once when we take the time to learn rules and practice them and whatnot, it gets us to a point where we also learn that we can break rules and kind of get more creative with things and, you know, do things for, we realize the purpose behind what we're doing, I think, a little bit more, and that drives us. Yeah, this is quite tightly framed. And I always tell folks, you got to always be careful of, again, Border Patrol, but like, make sure you're also giving enough space around your subject. I think that's the, you know, where we were looking at the image before this, Kristen's image, there was plenty of nice space around the photo for cropping or for putting in a frame or for matting. We always have to be careful that we don't get too close to the edges, because if a photo is going to be matted and printed, you're going to lose a half an inch all the way around, usually, at the matter. So you have to be careful with that.
Gary has noticed something that is a theme in these images, and maybe a theme in most photos, is that when you're putting something off into the third, it often is the right third in a person looking to the left.
That's correct. Yeah. And that's simply because in where we are, and we read left to right. So the image feels more natural to us to look at the negative space first and move to the subject. So that's almost a natural thing for us to look from left to right. Yep.
All right. So now we need to pick a winner of those photos. And I think what we need to do is we're going to need a small break. Just give us like 30 seconds. I'm going to put up a graphic. Let me put up a graphic. I don't want you and I to say a name. I both of us say a name, music. It'd be different. So we'll be back in just 1 second.
We're back.
Okay, now we have audio. We're back. All right. So now I've shown this before. I haven't said exactly what we're going to do with it. This is the Adobe Creative Cloud Photography Plan 1 year prepaid subscription to Photoshop and Lightroom. And the winner is going to get this. If you already have Photoshop and Lightroom, you know, if you already own it, then I don't know what you're going to do with it. You can, maybe if you don't want it, you can tell me I'll give it to somebody else. Or if you have somebody you want to give it to, you can do that. It is a physical thing, so I will have to mail it to you. But the winner of the JPEG to RAW Beginners Photo Group is Kristen Anderson, Kristen Lee Anderson. Congratulations, Kristen. Great photo. There were all the photos were good photos. You guys are really improving, and we'd like to see you join more of the monthly photo contest. Kristen, reach out to me either on Facebook or send me an email at podcast@jpegtoraw.com, or I'll reach out to you, and we'll talk about getting this over to you. You win the 1 year prepaid Adobe Creative Cloud plan, Photoshop and Lightroom. Awesome deal. And then after a year, you'd probably want to renew it yourself, because it is the, you know, the program that everybody uses, that we all use for photos. Yes. Okay. All right. That's our beginners group. Now we're going to talk about the regular group. We have 6 images in that we rolled it down to in the regular group. It started off, let me give you a little bit of background on how we go from all the images down to 6. So, you know, you entered your images into the contest. They go into a big group. The admins of our Facebook group, the normal JPEG to RAW group, then all vote on those things. We can vote on up to 6 images. We also star rate from 1 to 5 all of the images. So if there's a tie, that comes down to the star rating. The one with the higher rating would win. And only in this case, we had a rule where you could have entered more than one image. Only one of your images can make it to the top 6, though. So you can't take more than one spot. The top 6 then are picked from that, and they go to a committee to vote. AD, again this year, I think this is your 3rd year in a row, was one of our judges. Greg Benz, who was on the show a little while ago, does Lumensia plug-in for Photoshop. He was one of them, the judges, and then Tim and myself were one of the judges. So now, what's at stake? What do you have a chance to win? I'm going to pull this up. And AD doesn't even know, because he probably hasn't checked out my post, which is good. Let me find this. All right. So the finalists in this, and we'll go over the images here in just a second. The finalists are Gina Perry, Daryl Harrington, Greg Crosdill, I hope I'm not messing up your name too much, Debbie Henry, Millen, our friend Millen, and Bayradine, I'm not going to even try to say your last name, we'll go over these. Some of these you may have seen already because some of them may have been entered into one of our monthly contests. All right, what's up for grabs? First place is a $100 Amazon gift card. It'll be a virtual card. I will send it to you through email or Facebook, however that works. It's not one of these physical ones I've been showing you. This will be a virtual one, but it's just as good. AD's all-in-one bundle. This is what AD didn't know. I am buying it, regardless of what he tells me. I am buying it. AD's all-in-one bundle from his photo store and Greg Ben's Lomenzia. So great package there. That's for first place. Second place, or first runner-up, $50 Amazon gift card. AD's premium Lightroom preset pack. I'm buying that one too, AD. $25 Amazon gift card for third place or second runner-up. And another copy of AD's photo Lightroom preset pack. Then on top of that, we're going to give away two to somebody not in those top three. Two gifts to random people who entered into the contest. We're not going to announce this until next week, though, when we do all the other images. And that is a copy of Greg's Lomenzia and a copy of AD Wheeler's photo Lightroom premium Lightroom preset pack. One to one person, one to another person. So two people will get that. So even if you're not in the top three, you still have a chance to win something. This will, you know, if you've watched the show, you know that we lost our Amazon affiliation. This will pretty much wipe us out from the funds that we had from Amazon affiliation. So we'll have to figure out something for next year, but I got a lot of time for that until next year. And this is a small way we can give to you, the photographer, and a little bit to AD for all he's done for us and to Greg too. So now let's move on to the first photo. These are no particular order, so don't assume anything. The first photo is from Bayardine. Am I saying that right?
It looks like Bayardine.
Bayardine. Okay.
But yeah, that's a name and a half.
And I won't even get the last name.
Yeah, it's got to be phonetic for us.
This is the bride, the black and white bride sitting there. We've gone over this one before, so I don't know how detailed you want to go. But I think almost all of these are for one. We've gone over before in a previous contest.
So that was, and I left my comments. So you guys are kind of get, I'll give you my basic comments of, you know, you've kind of heard from me before when we looked at some of these images, I think, during the regular show. And I know some folks have done a little bit of work on some of them. Some of them have been reworked and whatnot to using some of that information, which is mm-hmm. awesome. And I think, you know, this photo, I love the high key light here. I love the rays coming in. I will say that, you know, the added rays are cool. I love, you know, a lot of times when I'm taking photos and I see a light ray and I try to capture it and it doesn't come out right or whatever. And then I'm going to take a creative license and I'm going to put them back in. You have to be very careful because there's a lot of physics behind light coming through windows. And if you don't get it right, then it's too easy to see, whatnot. I'm not so sure. I think they're a little too prominent here because I feel like, you know, the light rays are beautiful and they're competing with the other part of the photo, which is what this photo is really supposed to be about, which is the bride. Mm-hmm. So for me, there's too much competition between those really prominent light rays and the bride here. So I would really like to see those toned down a little bit, bring the layer back a little bit so that it's not so prominent in the image. I gave this a good score. I'm very going to be wrong. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming you are giving the images in the order I scored them, correct?
No, I didn't order you scored them. No, just in.
Oh.
Do I need to put them in? Because there were four of us, so we didn't all score the same.
No. The way you had them listed on the webpage.
Oh, no. Yeah.
They're in that order.
Yes. Yeah.
There we go. Okay. Cool. Because my order on my list that I have over here, folks, just so you know, is not this order at all. This is actually photo number three for me, but it's photo number one that I scored. I'm not going to talk about what my score was for this, but it got a good score for me. I like the image. I just little things like that. She's not quite in the third, and I'm not sure the way this is framed out, I can't tell whether or not the photo cuts off. It looks like there's a lot of dark in the image on the right. So I'm trying to change my frame size so I can actually see the real size of the image. Mm-hmm. So it looks like when I resize this, and I'm not sure if you guys are seeing it out there, but she's in the center and you've got this cool room. I really would have liked to seen her on the right. We just got done talking about this, right? And maybe in a more of a balancing situation, if you bring the light down a little bit coming out and you put her in the third, more in the third rather than in the like a dead center shot, you let the room work for the background and you really, because she's in the third, she will take the power of the image then. Whereas you have this big blacked out area on the right. It's like, you know, in my frame, I'm like, didn't notice it. But now that I've moved my frame so that I can actually see it, it's very like, you know, it doesn't balance the image well at all for me. It really draws me off. So I think that, you know, in with this particular image, putting the bride more over in the right-hand side and letting the room kind of do its thing and get that real dark area out of there. I can kind of see a little bit more on the rebroadcast actually than the actual image that I'm looking at, which is crazy.
Yeah, it's probably because it's a different, it's not contrasty or whatever. It's
right, exactly. Yeah. So I can see there's like a doorway there, right?
What do you think about if you came a little bit lower, you cropped in a little bit tighter, that moving her over to the right a little bit? The light rays are a little bit too overpowering, like you said, and distracting too much from her. And then you remove these chairs over on the left. So I think if you came down lower and a little bit tighter, they would move more to the left, but then you might have that, the back of that chair, you know, too much to the edge. So you'd have to remove those chairs. It's a lot of work to do all that.
Well, and so the other thing is too, not knowing the lens that was being used here, I'm going to assume 85 to 50 millimeters somewhere in there because there isn't much pincushion distortion to it. It depends. If you go lower with an image that's with a lens that's wider, you're going to end up distorting her mm-hmm. to the point where, and then also the room too. One of the ways to shoot real estate is to stay in the center between the ceiling and the floor. Dead on, and then shoot at a 45 degree angle so that everything kind of leads you into the image, which almost seems like that was kind of applied here. And I'm not sure. But that would be the correct thing to go about. I don't know. It would be something, Mike, that personally I would just have to experiment with. If you've got mm-hmm. this beautiful light coming in, I would hope, that they shot many, many, many different, angles. And I would love to, you know, again, love to see some of these and be able to give a little bit of input to kind of help people get over that creative bump. It's just be very careful with targeting people. Putting someone in the middle of the photograph, basically you're at odds with both of the things on each side. So our brains tend to freak out and we don't really focus. You'd think putting them in the middle makes a target, right? But that's not how photos work. We want to look at everything. We want to take in the whole image. Mm-hmm. And by putting the person in the center, it just makes it unbalanced, which seems like it would be balanced, but it's not. It's really not. It's competing between three different things, the right-hand side, the left-hand side, and her. And it's kind of swayed more to the left-hand side because when I first looked at it, I'll be honest with you, I didn't even think of the right-hand side here with the dark part of it. So that's cool, but I think the competition between the rays and her are really the story here. And you can get rid of that whole dark side unless you can lighten it up and kind of balance it out with the rest of the image. It's not really work. It's not. So when you look at an image like this, if it doesn't say I'm helping, then get rid of it. Yeah. You know, if it's not lending to the image, which I don't think it is. What's over there that's lending to the image? What's over there that's part of the story, right? If it doesn't come out as anything that's part of the story, then it shouldn't be there.
All right, very good. Next up is the shot from Millen.
Millen, buddy.
Our buddy Millen always does a great job of giving us a lot of detail in about his shots. And he did with this one. We've gone over this one in one of the monthly contests before. Mm-hmm. I don't remember what you said, AD. I love the tone of this one. Yep. A couple of things or one thing for sure for me is the tree at the end, which is where I'm being led with the trail. It's right dead center at the end of this trail. It's a little too small and too dark for me to be the main subject. So I go down the trail, and then I start veering off, and I go straight to the left where that light in the sky is. Mm-hmm. So for me in this image, I love the tone, I love the sky, I love the goldenness of the weeds and the field that's there, but nothing is holding me anywhere. Okay.
Yeah, it's,
that's the best I can do.
It's tough so let's talk about the tone first of all, because it is a very rich image as far as tones go. It's always difficult to get a cold sense and a warm sense to work together in an image. I think it works fairly well here. The sky is cold, it's blue, but it also has hints of the warm sun. So I think that works out. I think the wheat field being, and I know we talked about this originally in the image, the wheat field's got a nice golden glow to it. So that's cool. What on the right-hand side of this photo, I would ask this right to Millen, if you're watching or listening or you get to watch this, please tell me what on the right-hand side of this photo is worth being there. I know that seems harsh, but there is nothing on the right-hand side that I want to look at in this image. I want to look at the road, the tree, the clouds, and the sun, and none of that is on the right-hand side of the image. So while he did a lot of work taking 12 vertical images here to make this beautiful mm-hmm. big panorama, I think that the composition here could have been so much better if he would have shot more to the left, made the tree... put the tree and the road, have the road coming right out of the corner on the, so the right hand of the road coming out of the right hand corner, put the left hand part of the road coming out of the center of the image out to that tree, and then had balanced it with the sun breaking the clouds coming in. There's your story. The sun coming in to light the tree at the end of the road. So while the tree might be small, there could be a story behind that, but we put this stuff on the right, which, you know, I'm looking over there trying to see something that is of interest and why it would be included with all these other powerhouses that are in this image. Light rays and the road and the sky, that's power, right? But what on the right is giving me power, and there really isn't. So for me, it's like I would chop that all off.
Yeah, and I don't remember what he said in his write-up. You don't think he was wanting the road and the two, you said wheat field, two wheat field, you know, columns on either side of the road
sure.
being his frame to the tree?
Yeah, well, let's talk about that a little bit. So it's basically, there's no such thing as kind of abstract. So I hope that makes sense. It's either abstract or it's not. There's also no such thing as kind of symmetrical. So it's either symmetrical or it's not. So if you're going to put something close to symmetrical, you're going to unbalance and make the scene uneasy. And this is not symmetrical. Okay. If you're going to be symmetrical, you've got to nail that road. Now, this image, I can tell you right now, could be edited. I could edit this so that road was dead straight. With the image that he has right here, it can be done. It's a lot of Photoshop work and whatnot. But I think it's more important to go into the field. No pun intended. But I think it's more important to go out there and to kind of know that when you're out there. Know that I got to make sure that, you know, however I line this shot up, if I'm going to make that road be the center point, then it needs to be in the center, and it's not right now. It's veering ever so slightly to the right. It's not balanced with the field on each side. So he needed to move more to his left and stay focused on that tree. And at that point, he's probably going to lose that break in the clouds unless he shoots even wider. So, you know, I don't think that the shot was obtainable in that sort of fashion at that time. Could he come back at another time? When those clouds were dramatic and there was a sun coming down in the right, yeah, absolutely, and get that head on right down the middle. It's just a case of the right place, right time, right composition, and then learning to think on the fly and maybe say, okay, today isn't the symmetrical day. Let's do the, you know, have it in the thirds and see if I can balance that late sun with that. It's just right now it's kind of in between everything for me. Mm-hmm. But coming back to the stronger parts of it, the toning, and you know, he talks a little bit about using define and some sharpening here. I think he, you know, your technical side, milling, you're nailing, you got the technical side down. Now the hard part is kind of letting go and letting the creative side take over. And, you know, we have to, I always hate telling this to people because they like go out in the field. And I had one of my students one time tell me, you know, I used to love photography until I started working with you. And now every time, I go out into the field, I think about this stuff. And I basically had to reassure my apprentice at the time that I was teaching that, yep, that's right. You're going to hate me for a long time, and that's fine, and I'm okay with it. At some point in time, though, my voice will go away, and you will just absorb, and things will happen, and your creative force will be 10 times as strong as it was before. So, and I have students that I've taught that will come back and tell you that that is the case. But it was awful funny. I remember at the time hearing that that. I used to have fun until I met you.
I took a little weekend trip. Speaking of that, I took a little weekend trip with my wife this past weekend. And I was out taking some photos of the little area we were in. And I heard AD's voice. And you know, I set up. I got my tripod. I framed my shot. And I was about to shoot. And I go, wait a second. I gotta, you know, think about what AD would tell me if I was here. So I tried to what is that? Channel my inner AD. I didn't do a very good job of it, but at least, you know, at least I started thinking about what do I need to do. And that's, I think that's the key is, and I know Millen is doing this, is, you know, sitting there trying to think, all right, you know, how can I do that? And I think that's the progression. Yes. The progression of getting to get better photos is not just setting up your tripod and shooting, is thinking about what you're going to do. All right. You ready to go to the next one?
Yeah, I just would add to that Millen's been with us since the first contest, and mm-hmm. I can safely say that, yeah, I'm being hard on him only because I know that he's in it to win it. So he's willing to accept that. And his progress has been amazing since he's been submitting images to this. So I, you know, at some point in time, what we ought to do is like a yearly look back.
Oh,
and
that'd
like
be awesome.
some of these folks who have been submitting images and what they first submitted to what they're doing now is just, it's incredible. So,
yep. All right. Next up is Gina Perry, with this image of the little girl who's, I'm going to mess this up. I can't remember if it's her mom or a dad that's getting married to, you know, getting married here. And she is in tears of joy for this as a black and white photo. You know, and I know, let me get rid of that. We don't all agree on the voting that we did here. There are only two portraits in the whole group. And that was pointed out to me, of six finalists, four of them are landscape and the other two are portrait. And then the majority of the judges are more landscape people. However, I will say that I think that, you know, we all looked at these, each one of them objectively. And this one actually, there I do have at least one major issue for me in this one, but it is one of my favorites. I did like this. I like the toning. You know, Gina is always awesome with her editing. I love the emotion. And for me, there was emotion in this and the little girl crying. And I like the fact she cut off the groom and bride's head so that I'm really focused on just the girl. To me, she's the main subject here. However, on the left-hand side, whatever this is, I can't tell what that is. This thing's that jabbing out all the way to the groom's arm, and then somewhere about halfway through, there's a white spot. I don't know what in the world that is, but for me, I do look at the girl, I see her emotion in her face, but then I keep coming back to that big white spot and that thing that's jetting out. And I don't know what it is.
Well, I'm going to start out by saying, Gina, you know, I love you. So that's where we're going to start. So just remember that you've been in this like since the beginning too. And I love that you submit your images and you know, I follow your work. So I think it's awesome. I don't think this is your best work though. And the reason why is it's the same reason that Mike chose, and I don't know whether it's a rude A rude relative jumping in the way, which I've been there. You know, like I'm the paid photographer and some relative with an iPhone decides that they should get the shot. I'm like, hey, I'm getting paid for this and have a contract. But anyways, I think that, you know, it's what you wrote is Ruby was so overcome by happiness for her parents. She cried at the ceremony and the exchange of rings. When I looked at this image, I did not read your caption. I don't read captions first and then look at images. I do not want to be swayed by words. I want to look, take it all in, and then I want to read what you wrote and then see if anything gels together there. I, you know, because of the situation of two people being, I didn't know that it was her parents, although I, you know, could assume because she's the ring bearer. I knew that she had to have some sort of relationship here. I don't get tears of happiness. Unfortunately, she just looks sad. And I'm trying my hardest to put a tear of happiness in there. And I love that you captured the tear. I can see it. I think I'm with Mike here. Zoom in on this a little bit. I think you could cut out those folks even more. We can see that she's looking at the hand. Maybe at that point, the story doesn't need to be happy or sad. It's emotion at that point. That's all we need to know. Mm-hmm. And then we can let our brains kind of, you know, take that into effect. Now, that is an artistic look or creative look at the image. As far as you doing work for these folks, they're gonna love this no matter what. Mm-hmm. You captured a decisive moment. Right at the point of the ring going on and her looking right at the ring, boom. So it doesn't matter. They're going to already have emotions instilled in them from the moment they were there. So that's why images like this can have many opinions about whether they're good or whether they're bad. It just depends on how you're looking at them. And this is why it's so important to say exactly why you press the shutter button. So, you know, in this case, this isn't going to be an art image. This isn't going to be, you know, on the cover of some book someplace. This is a image for these folks to enjoy. So you captured that moment. So I think it's a win all the way around, no matter what you do with the image. I do agree with the thing sticking out and it is a distraction and we can talk about, you know, that stuff all day long, but it is a great image and well done, well captured, well toned as usual, from Gina. She always does an excellent job with the tone of her images.
You know, there's, and I don't want to be a sexist here. You know, I have a wife and love my wife. And so this is just my personal experience. So ladies, don't send me hate mail.
Don't judge.
Yeah, I think that, you know, tears of happiness are more common in females than they are in males. And although I've been married to my wife for almost 24 years now, I still don't get it. I don't, you know, when I see her crying, I assume that something's wrong and not tears of happiness. And I say, what's the matter? And, you know, she says, no, I'm happy. And so, you know, that to me, when I first looked at it, I thought the same thing. Why? What is she upset about? And then I read Gina's thing and realized that, no, this is tears of happiness. And it, to me, of all the images here, this one was, for me, the most powerful of that. Even if it was her mad, there's power in that too, for me. So it was one of my favorites. I think if it was for the thing on the left hand side, somebody mentioned in chat it might have been a book. You know, I don't know because there's a white thing there too. That to me is what's holding this back. But if I am like you said, these two people, I got this on my wall.
Absolutely.
At the house. Yeah. Because this is powerful stuff for me. All right, let's move on to the next one, which is from Debbie Henry.
Yes.
Where is that? Nope, not Millen. Let me find Debbie Henry. Debbie Henry. And you'll notice in I think all of these that if there is a watermark, it's blended in. In Gina's image, there was a watermark, but we didn't even talk about the watermark because we probably didn't even notice it, but it was there over in the lower left-hand side. I don't think Debbie has one here. So, you know, these are, and I think Bayradine, I'm saying your name wrong, I'm sure, he had one too, but they're very subtle. So, but this image from Debbie Henry, this is, I believe she was walking on a trail. I don't have the notes in front of me here. Walking on a trail, and is this a early morning sun coming through the trees with the fog and everything there? And I think to her, she was just recovering from some kind of health issue or something. So I think this had some kind of spiritual meaning to her. In this image, for me, doing border patrol, which I'm learning from AD, on the lower left-hand side, there's some dark branches there that I might have tried to clone out or lighten up or something, so they're not quite so obvious over there. That's about the limit of where I can go.
You're bailing so soon.
I know.
That ain't right. Well, I agree. It is a Border Patrol thing. You got a beautiful image here. Don't undersell the fact that if you're lucky, you get fog. You went out early in the morning. Conditions are right. You'll learn, you know, if you don't know already, there's certain conditions that will almost guarantee you fog. And there's certain times of year in certain parts of the country that you can almost get it every day. And, you know, when that happens, you should be out there if you want that sort of look. To get that atmosphere, be out there every day looking for the shot like this. It's a beautiful shot. I think the tone on this is great. I wouldn't contrast it any more than it is. I think that's what my favorite part of this is the overall toning and the different layers of light really works well for me. The composition is good. I like how it moves from the light to the dark on the right, and it does it in a very gradual sense, but it's done naturally. I would definitely clone out the pine trees interfering there. And there's little things here, like the pine tree that's hanging like kind of out in the middle. There's a couple of branches that they look like they're dead, and they have like little maybe a pine cone at the end or something. I probably would touch those up and get rid of them and just make this nice and soft. Now, you don't have to get rid of the whole branch, but take the little dot out of there that's of ultra contrast, because it begins to look like a speck and our eyes are drawn to that. This is a very soft image and very, again, to go back to a very surreal or ethereal image. I think that this, makes me think of, Dungeons and Dragons and that sort of, thing, Game of Thrones kind of opening scenes. It's very cinematic. So do your Border Patrol, do a little bit of touch up. This was real high on my list. So, yep. And I'm a, sorry, portrait folks. I'll be honest with you, I don't think I'm qualified enough. I've done a lot of portrait work, a lot of weddings, but I don't think I'm the most qualified person as far as my portfolio goes. I can help you in aspects of that. But for me, landscapes, when it comes to landscapes and knowing what I know, I can look at an image and I can tell you, if it's a winner or not. And I think this one's real close. So, yeah. And it's an image that can be worked. So there's still stuff here to work.
Yeah. And two things for me for next year. One, I'm always going to ask AD to be a judge. So as long as he wants to, I'm going to want him to. And then I generally pull from the guest from that year. I think next year I'm going to do try more to get a more balanced judge panel where we have some portrait photographers and, not all male. So it was all male this year. So
yeah, I have a great suggestion for that too.
So, good. Yeah. Good. So. All right, so that was from Debbie Henry, and I think this next one is the only one of – I don't remember this one being submitted in a previous contest, so this may be only one of the six that we've not gone over in a previous show, and that is from Greg let me pull up his name.
Crosdale.
Greg right. Crosdale. I love the golden tone in this. I'm not sure about the – you're going to get me on the whole symmetrical thing here, but I also like that. The sky is good looking to me. I love the rough skies on the rough seas on the right, and the barrier here holding them back, and the calm seas on the left. I like that part of the image too. The lighthouse and the barrier here holding back the sea, so to say, that whole contrast there. This one is one of my favorites in the whole group.
Yeah, mine too. And I have to kind of be a little honest here with everyone. So when I was doing the judging for this image, it was very high on my list. I didn't look at who the photographer was. Greg is a student of mine.
Ah.
So and when you said his name when we started the broadcast, I'm like, what? uh-oh. So, yeah. So Greg basically, you know, he textbooked this photo for sure. And he got the symmetry right. And he divided, you know, he used the lighthouse as a focal point. Remember that targeting thing I was talking about and everything leading to that. And then the calm seas on one side and the rough seas on the other, and the overall tonality of it, the shininess of the, mm-hmm. The water. I mean, good time of day, rocks and concrete and all that kind of stuff always look better with water on them, wet. That's why going out after a rainstorm is always great for urban photography. So yeah. An excellent shot. I really, you know, if anything for me, the one person standing out on out on the pier there, I don't know as I would have left that person in the shot, only simply because they're so small and so tiny that they're almost at the point of inconsequentiality to the whole image. Mm-hmm. So if it's going to, you know, have a person for scale, I guess. I guess that's okay. I just would have liked to maybe seen that person maybe a little closer. I don't know. And here's just a top tip for you guys. If you're shooting an image like this and you're all set up, you're generally going to shoot a bunch of images to try to get the waves to look right. You're not going to, you know, just snap one photo at just the right time. Parts of these images can be all assembled where maybe the waves looked good at the first part and then down farther on the actual, you know, on the pier, the waves might have not looked as rough or the sea might not have looked as rough. So you might add, you know, a couple of images together and edit them together so the waves look nice and dramatic. So you're going to take many shots. And so I'm looking over here and Greg says that it's a life ring that's out there.
So maybe it's not a person.
It's not a person. So then I definitely would have removed it, Greg. So, because it to me is what I'm seeing on I'm looking at this on an ultra wide monitor right now. So I'm not seeing it full screen, but I'm seeing it as big as a 1080p monitor would show me on one side. And it's still very hard to see that it's not a figure of a person down there. You know, when there's a question like that, I usually something like that, I probably would have removed it. But that's personal preference. That's up to you. But yeah, overall, I really like the image. And if you do have a person, I guess what I was getting at, if you do have a person who's walking the pier, don't be afraid to just keep your camera right where it's at and just keep shooting, keep shooting, keep shooting. And if they get into a position where they look awesome, you might cut that part of the frame in on the overall scene that you keep. So yeah, an image like this is easy to do that sort of thing if you're not moving around a lot. But
great image, Greg.
I'm going to have to – I'm sorry to Greg, but you probably might want to actually omit my scores from Greg's photo. I'll leave that up to the discretion of the powers that be, though, because I did not know – honestly did not know going into it. That's the tidbit that I have. So
I'm looking at it, and it wouldn't have made a difference. You know, that's – one judge is not – there's enough buffer here that one judge was not going to move it enough.
Oh, okay.
And I'm not saying whether Greg placed at all in this.
Right.
Sure. But what I am saying is that with or without your score, it wouldn't have changed anything.
Gotcha. Okay.
All right. So last one up is from Daryl Harrington. Let me find his name here. This one, I know we've gone over this before. I'm not positive if he has done any retouching to this one or not. And to be honest, I don't remember your critique before. There was some critique you had before. But this one, of course, is the Milky Way with the observatory over there on the right-hand side, the clouds down in the valley below. And then I think that is a large city in a distance out there where you can see the lights. And I believe it's over in Hawaii, somewhere in over in Hawaii.
Yep.
And I love this photo. I love Milky Way shots. And this one has the added, you know, what do you call it, observatory there that adds to that. And the fact that he's above the clouds, I think is super cool. I'm doing my border patrol. I don't see too much problem with the border, except maybe that little building that's over in the far right of the observatory. But, and I guess maybe what you could have done there is crop that a little bit to crop that out. And I'm not looking at it full size here either. Were there people in this image around the observatory?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think so.
I'm all right with the glow down there from the city. I mean, that adds to me. That's all right.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Well, I guess for me, I know he did work on this image. Definitely okay. Has done some good work on this image. There's a couple of things that I'm seeing. There is a repeating pattern. If you go to the observatory and then look diagonally up left, before you get to the Milky Way, there's a repeating pattern of stars there, and it looks like kind of one of the stars has got an inside out kind of almost embossed kind of look to it. It looks like there might have been something there that he tried to clone out, and that's a very tough thing to do when you're dealing with stars. So always, you know, be aware of that sort of thing. There's also on the left-hand side of the image, if you go all the way over to the left edge about, I don't know, a little bit in, you can see doubling of stars over there on the left edge. So if you come in about, I'd say if you're on a 1080 screen, if you came in about an inch and a half from the left-hand side and follow, go to the hill and then go straight up from the hill, you can see patterns of stars that are doubled. And this is where things were cloned out, and it just picked the nearest neighbor and copied them over. And that's something you got to be watching out for when you're doing things like this, because it's just obvious there was something there and was erased.
Oh, just maybe like I'm gonna say an inch, but it depends on how big of a sky you're looking, how big of a monitor you're looking at. It's where you got, I see it there, there's a, if you see in the lower left hand side, there's a bright dot slightly to the right of that, and then up a little bit. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Where you've got that pattern of space and then a little bit of the pattern again?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. So if you look, I'll do this. I know, Mike, you know what to do.
I'm getting ready.
Do that. So you're looking at my screen now. You guys should be able to see that. Mike's going to call it up for you. So where I'm looking at, Daryl, if you're following along here at home, if you look right here, you've got several stars that kind of repeat themselves. The other place is also right here. There's also some repeating patterns of stars. And it's just one of those things. There's also some more up here where you probably had something in there. Using a content aware probably isn't the best thing to do with star fields. I usually like to use a heel brush, and I'll mark out an area across the screen, and then I'll use the heel to just kind of dab in there to remove the object, and that will put a random pattern in there that won't do what it's doing right now, which is, you know, obviously, like I said, shows a copy and paste, and we don't want to do that. Another thing with this image that I'm seeing that I didn't see before, and this might be something that he did in post that he's not aware of, but I'm getting quite a bit of blue and green banding in the image. So I'm seeing like what looks like color cast through the image of green and then purple.
You don't think
and
that's light
green.
Pollution?
I don't think it is, simply because of the way that it's kind of patchy here. It doesn't usually go pink to green. Usually light pollution is kind of an orangish, if anything, or yellow. That's usually happens from a sharpening or something of that, that going on with the image. Now, with that said, the original image might not show this. So this has had to go through the internet. So what happens with a lot of images is that the gamut starts out one way, and then when we upload it to a couple of services, by the time it gets to us, something like that. So that's just something I want Daryl should just look and see if he's seeing that too. It's very easy to get rid of if you do have it. You can actually use the chromatic aberration setting to pick those colors, and it'll remove them out of there. But I think everything he did to the image is great. I would probably bring up your contrast a little bit more, Daryl, and you've got some stuff appearing. It looks like the road or something here in the bottom of the image. And on my monitors, on all three of my monitors, it's actually, I'm not seeing a lot of detail there. I'm just kind of seeing, I don't know what you're seeing, Mike.
Yeah, I'm seeing that too. So just make it go to black.
I think I would. I think because, again, what you kind of brought up right at the beginning when we started talking about this, the observatory, the Milky Way, the clouds, and the city. So let's not add anything more to that. That's a little bit much, actually, I'll be honest with you. So it's okay, though, because they're all very powerful. But let's not add anything more to try to see. It's not a Where's Waldo, right? That's not what we want to go with photos. We want to make the story very strong and easy to get. That's going to be your most – that's there's power in that. So power and simplicity. So I would just – if it's inconsequential, if it's not, you know, amazing, then you've got amazing things here. Don't let that other stuff take away, because that's what will happen when people see that sort of thing. That'll take away from the amazement of the Milky Way and everything. But the processing of the Milky Way, he's done his homework there, and a great moment to capture, especially in Hawaii. I mean, that's awesome.
And Daryl is out there in chat. He did say that this is a pano and that he didn't clone anything. So it might have been the stitching process in Lightroom or something. Because he said he did all the processing in Lightroom.
Okay. So if you run into that and you do, you know, again, Border Patrol, if you do get that, a stitching error, then it's your duty to go in and get rid of it. So it doesn't look like a cut and paste. Doesn't matter how it got there. I'm just saying that part of finishing your image is – you know, to eliminate that, because people, here's what's going to happen. All right. Your peers are going to look at it. People like myself and Mike and everyone else out there who you're involved with in the photographic community. And they're going to be like, why didn't he take care of that? It's a beautiful image. He just didn't finish it. And, you know, it's not going to get the accolades that it needs, that it deserves, because of something simple like that. Cause it's to us guys, we look at it, it sticks out like a sore thumb. And then, you know, that's all I can see now in the image. So, you know, go with the power, take a few, you know, you might spend 90 hours on an image and you needed to spend 91. I mean, it happens to me all the time.
You spend 90 hours on images.
Oh, I have, Mike, I have done images, and come back to them three or four times. So the amount of hours sometimes that go into an image might be way even beyond that. I don't know.
I guess you got to find something to do when you're 3D printing stuff.
Right. Exactly.
All right. That's
not going to let me let that down.
No. I think it's awesome. I wish I was doing that. All right. Okay. So that is the six images that are there. And again, the top three are going to win something. We're going to announce that here in just a second. Everybody else that was entered in that does have a chance to win either AD's Premium Lightroom Preset Pack or Greg Benz's Lumensia, one of those two. And we'll announce those two things next week. So tonight it's going to be the top three. So starting from number three, you ready for this? And number three wins a $25 Amazon.com gift card and 80s Premium Lightroom Preset Pack. And number three, coming in number three in this, and remember, even being in top six, I forget how many images were entered. I am playing all the entries behind me on that monitor back there, although we haven't been showing me that much. But there were a lot of great photos. And in some cases, somebody like Gina Perry, and I know Millen had some, and Bayreuthine had some, and I think Daryl had more than one, too, where they had more than one image that could have made it to the finals, but we had to pick their top image, the one that got the most votes. So coming in number three is the image from Daryl. Congratulations, Daryl. Daryl wins the $25 Amazon gift card and the Premium Lightroom Preset Pack.
Nice job.
Congratulations, Daryl. All right, coming in at number two is the image from Bayredine. I know I'm saying your name wrong. The bride image coming coming from Bayer. That's where I'm going to go. You can send it to me phonetically, and then I'll try and say it better. You win a $50 Amazon.com gift card and 80s premium Lightroom preset pack. All right. Now the final image. The winner of the 2016 Jay Beta Raw photo contest is Greg. Greg did win. You get a $100 Amazon.com gift card, 80s all-in-one bundle from his photo store, and Greg Benz's Lemenzia. So congratulations, Greg. You know, we talked about 80. If we had removed your vote, it wouldn't have made a difference. That was a high mark on everybody's vote there. It was tight. You know, a lot of these votes were tight, but not tight enough. That one did pull away from the group. It's a fantastic image. All six were really good images, but that one is our winner for the 2016 contest. Congratulations, Greg. If you're a winner, send me an email at podcast@jpedro.com or through Facebook. You can find me on Facebook. You know, of course, you're in the group with me. If you don't respond in a couple of days, I'll be sending out an email to you to get that process started, because I will need a little bit of information from you to get you these things. So congratulations. Next week, right, AD, we're going to go over some of the other photos that were entered. I'm trying to pick ones that were not entered in a previous contest, so we'll hit some new stuff. And so I don't think it's 10 images. I think it's a little bit less than that. We'll do that next Wednesday, I believe, right?
Yes, and I plan... Right now, I plan on having the first episode of Photo GT ready to roll.
So. Ooh, awesome. You want to hint us on what it's going to be about?
What gear? Yeah. If anybody hasn't been following along, it's the first show is going to be on art lenses, such as we have the Lens Baby here. I think this is the Velvet 56, and we've got also the this is from Meyer Optics. This is the Trio Plan 100 and their Bokeh Monsters, both of them. So we'll be talking about the worth of art lenses, and are they any good? Are they worth it? Are they worth the big money? That's what we're going to be doing.
Yeah, very good. In closing on this, obviously, the kind of gifts we're giving away are not life-changing. So that's the point of this, is not the gifts. We don't want to give away a little bit of a prize so that, we show there's some appreciation there and help out a little bit. The main thing in Internet's contest is the learning process. Especially with the feedback you're getting from AD, you generally have to pay for this kind of feedback to get this kind of stuff. But learning from this, even if you didn't submit an image, listen to what he says about some of these things. In my mind, I think I'm going to say in every photo I take now, Border Patrol. I may not get it right every time. I probably won't, but I'll be thinking about that. And that is the thing there. If you're not into just taking snapshots, and nothing wrong with that. That's what you want to do. Just take snapshots. That's fine. It's all my wife wants to do, is just take snapshots. If you're wanting to move beyond taking snapshots, entering these little contests like this, there's very little pressure in these. We're not going to beat you up. It's not that big of a deal. I know Daryl enters a lot. I know Millen enters a lot. Gina enters a lot. Just forcing yourself to get out there and take photos and then entering something like this, it helps you grow. And hearing the feedback from AD is awesome. And I generally don't enter the contest, but I am learning just from hearing AD's critiques of other people. It's an incredible opportunity. That's all I got to say.
Thanks, man.
That's all I got to say. So I know we're here in an odd night, AD. We've gone over almost an hour and a half now, so I'm going to go ahead and try and wrap this up. And we're back next Wednesday. We have a guest, Lynn. I think it's a friend of yours. Lynn, where do I have her name? I don't have her name.
Wazicki.
Lynn Wazicki. We're talking about bird photography. I don't think we've talked about that subject before.
She is also one of my students, and her birding photography down in Florida will blow your mind. Yeah. I mean, I know people, I've said this before, I know people that can't take a clear photo of a person standing still in front of them. And I'm one of those people that has a problem with that once in a while. Lynn takes pictures of birds going like 60 miles an hour and they're tack sharp.
Yeah. That's
incredible. I mean, razor sharp. It's incredible. And she gets some amazing images. So, she's going to be doing some workshops this year and, yeah, exciting time for her, for sure. So you definitely want to tune in and check out Lynn's work. It's amazing.
We'll have Lynn next Tuesday. And then right after that, next day, Wednesday, we'll be doing the photo review show, the once-a-month photo review show, show number 9.
Yep,
wow. All right, so until next week, keep it raw. Good night, everybody.
Bye.